Welcome to Turnpike Sports. I am Dave Weishottle, and as always, I am joined by my producer and co-host, Doug Weishottle. Doug, what's up?
Oh, a few things. Most notably, it was almost time for the Alliance of American Football to give up after 1 week.
I cannot believe that news report that they almost ran out of money after their first week. I mean, which is shocking to me. It's shocking. I heard the news that they had to be bailed out by the Carolina Hurricanes owner.
Depends on who you talk to.
All right.
Because according to the AAF, they were going to be doing this investment anyway.
Well, that's silly. I don't know what that means or that's crazy. But apparently, after the first week, the players did not get paid or their checks didn't clear or something like that.
They almost didn't get paid.
For 10 days after their first. I mean, I thought this one was actually going to hit the ground running. I mean, they're on CBS. It looks like they have incredible people involved in it at the official levels. I mean, great coaches, good ownership, and all of a sudden now this happens.
I think I mentioned it to you when we were watching the first weekend's games that it almost, the way they were broadcasting and everything, it almost had the feel to brokered time almost, where they bought time on the networks, and I think they may have overbought off the bat.
I mean, I thought this was an actual contract. I thought it was let me tell you something. Their ratings were very, very good.
2.1 for the first weekend.
They beat the NBA some games.
And actually,
most games, actually.
They did extremely well. It's just that, you know, when you look at the stats, I mean, I pulled some of this stuff up before. You got their entire payroll for the year is $34
million. Okay.
And they didn't have enough to cover that after taking care of, I guess, marketing, publicity, TV time, all that stuff.
Okay.
So they may not have even brought that in, you know, depending on who you're talking to. I know Ebersol came out and said that they had just changed payroll systems, which was the cause of that screw up.
Okay. That's what they're saying. That's why the players didn't get paid for 10 days after their first
game.
Okay.
Well, again,
I'm curious to see. I mean, beyond monetary, I'm curious to see if the ratings sustain themselves. I mean, I'm not sure. I haven't seen the second week ratings. But I got to be honest with you, this weekend, I did not watch them. I watched them the first week because I was curious. I didn't watch them the second week.
I didn't watch them because I didn't know what channel they were on. They weren't on CBS again.
Really? Interesting.
A couple games, I think, were on TNT. They had ESPN. They were all over the board with wherever it was being carried. And I don't know exactly who was carrying them last weekend.
Interesting.
So, you know, they may have had one game on CBS. I think they had one of the primetime games because they did again. Saturday was late games. Actually, both of them were. I think they were both 3, 4 o'clock starting.
Saturdays, I think they do the 4 o'clock, 8 o'clock,
well,
or 4:30 and 8:30.
I think they do it
like that
way, too, with Sundays. But, you know, again, I didn't know where to watch it. And maybe that's just my fault for not going to the AAF site and checking it out.
Mm-hmm.
But I just couldn't tell where they were. I didn't even know what time the games were, to be honest with you. And it's just amazing that they let something like this happen right off the bat. I mean, the guy came in with $250 million, the owner of the Panthers.
And I guess he was...
Named chairman.
Named chairman. I guess that's what $250 million gets you.
Obviously, so, this was
I gotta tell you.
But according to the AAF, this was all planned.
I hope one of these spring football leagues works out. Because, look, I was a big fan of the USFL. I mean, I think it had great players. It had Hall of Fame players. And I hope, you know, one of these spring football leagues really bursts out and gets some really great football, really great players. I mean, I was impressed the first week of the AAF. I mean, it had some pretty decent football. But let's see where it goes. Let's see if it survives.
As long as it doesn't end up what the XFL did. The last 2 weeks of the XFL's existence, they didn't pay anybody.
Really? I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Boy.
So,
unbelievable.
You know, if they're going to have money problems, do it now. In the first 2 weeks.
Get it all sorted
exactly.
out.
Exactly. Because $250 million additional money should cover payroll for at least a couple of weeks, depending on what they're using that money for.
I wonder if, you know, if it would help if they got some teams in the Northeast. It seems like all of these teams are on the West Coast and, you know, in a lot smaller markets than, you know, like a New York or a Philly or a Chicago.
I just wonder if their model is flawed in some way.
Something's
going on.
I hope they get it together. Football any time of the year is great.
But, you know, let's see what happens with the AAF. Like you said, hopefully this could succeed. This could be the next football league. Mm-hmm. Before we get too far into the show, to get in touch with us, you can call or text us at 609-512-5910, 609-512-5910, and email us at info@turnpikesportsradio.com.
And, you know, I want to remind everyone, I got a great interview coming up with Matthew Cullen, who is the Senior Vice President of Interactive Gaming and Sports at the great Parx Casino, one of my favorite casinos in the world. We're going to talk about sports betting, what Parx is doing with regard to sports betting, both at the casino place.
And
the two turf clubs. And he even has some interesting plans for the online platform for Parx Casino. So stick around. Matthew Cullen is a great interview. And, hey, ready for our trip down the turnpike? All right. Today's trip down the turnpike is brought to you by Drizzly, your online liquor store. Available in over 95 cities across North America, Drizzly offers a huge selection and competitive pricing with a side of personalized content. Now there's no need to leave the house. Get alcohol delivered in less than an hour by Drizzly. Head on over to drizzly.com and order today. And now get $5 off your first order of $20 or more when using promo code DRINK19 at checkout. Shop beer, wine, and liquor with drizzly.com.
Exit 1.
Okay, we're going to do some sports betting updates here. Pennsylvania finally released their January sports betting numbers.
Speaking of Parx Casino, we got some of their numbers.
Statewide handle was $32 million and generated a $2.6 million revenue boost for the state. Sugar House was the best one, $10.7 million in handle.
Well, Sugar House has been open the longest, hasn't it been? Because yep. I know in second place, Parx is, I don't know what the number is. What is it?
Parx is third.
Parx is third, but they only open a couple of weeks in January, so that's pretty damn good.
You actually had three places that were only open a couple of weeks. Parx itself, South Philly Turf Club, and also Harris Philly. Mm-hmm. They were the trailers, and that's only because they weren't open as long as everybody else. So
I think it's pretty good numbers. I mean, this is not like...
They doubled what they did in December.
Which is outstanding because... This is very new to Pennsylvania. They only have physical sports books, which is important because, I mean, New Jersey did very well in sports betting because of their mobile sports betting. And Pennsylvania doesn't even have that yet. So I think the future is bright in Pennsylvania.
Yeah, except for that huge tax that they charge.
Well, what are you going to do?
Yep.
Hey, if they're willing to pay it, you know, the state's willing to take it.
Well, you know, Pennsylvania showed some good signs. You still got some more developments coming in New Jersey, too. A physical update on FanDuel Meadowlands. They just introduced their self-service betting kiosks, which should speed up people betting at the tellers and everything else. So,
sure.
You know, they were getting massive crowds. They were getting back delays, all that stuff. So, you know, it's one of those things where it's a convenience more so than anything. But it's good to see that they're,
constantly doing that. They need that. They're in such a high population area, and they get such big crowds that they need these kiosks.
Yep. And going further down the state to Atlantic City, I guess this is technically Atlantic City because it's the Golden Nugget Online Sportsbook was launched. This is actually nice because it's an integrated wallet with their online casino. And these guys may be the only ones that can actually compete with FanDuel and DraftKings. Golden Nugget Online is the leader across the board in terms of casino. So maybe they have a shot at dethroning one of the two biggies for online sportsbooks.
They're really late at the game, though.
Well, you know, it's one of those things where you got to realize that a lot of the time is first to market doesn't mean best in market.
Sure.
So it could be just a matter of.
But they missed the entire football season.
Well, they're also going to miss the entire NBA season because they can't bet on NBA.
Oh, that's right. Oh my God. Yeah, that's interesting. The Golden Nugget was it?
No NBA betting because of Tillman Fertitta.
Tillman Fertitta, who owns the Houston Rockets, I guess he worked out a deal where he can have sports betting at the Golden Nugget, which he owns.
Yep.
But he can't bet on the NBA. Unbelievable.
And they
can't offer NBA
betting. They can't do any NBA betting.
Unbelievable.
But they can do Oscars.
They can do Oscars, okay.
And like I said, it's one of those things, it's totally integrated into the online casino. So the amount of traffic that online casino has may actually benefit the online sportsbook better than you know, the NBA lack of, or the lack thereof of betting as on NBA betting, as well as the late to market here.
I got to tell you, when it comes to online casinos, I mean, that live dealer thing that they have put them over the top. And I think, I think that will help their online sports book.
They also have one of the biggest categories of online slots, too. So that's one of the big things that their online casino can't be matched by anybody.
No, I think it's really good. I think everyone's following in their footsteps. I know Borgata now has online dealers.
Yep, live dealers.
So, you know.
Yeah, so, you know, trendsetters, but like I said.
Should translate into a big audience for their sports book. They have a good online presence.
They may have probably the best chance. Sure. To capture a good market share of the online sports books, because everybody else can't catch FanDuel and DraftKings. All righty. A couple other things. Sacramento Kings have now an in-game sports betting app that really isn't sports betting.
Are they calling it a sports betting app, or are they calling it something different? I know they keep calling it a predictive app.
That's exactly what it is, predictive gaming. Basically, it's just almost like a little trivia game kind of thing where – you know, they're looking at, fans will be able to place free predictions on game outcomes in the new Sacramento Kings Skyloft Predictive Gaming Lounge.
Oh, they actually have a lounge.
Yep.
Okay. But they also have an app and a lounge where you can do both these things.
Yeah, huh? And these are the categories to make quote-unquote predictions. Margin of victory, total team points, player blocks, turnover, steals, triple-doubles. Yeah, you know, and they're playing for credits, not for money.
So credits mean a certain number of credits.
They can
get prizes or something.
Kings gear,
okay.
Game tickets, raffle tickets for other things, even cash prizes through the raffle tickets. So, you know, it's one of those things where this is going to be it's in-game betting, but it's not really betting. If you want to, you know, throw that out there like that, I don't know. I wish them well because it's actually. Good to see. This would actually put them in good position if California ever passes sports betting.
Okay.
But right now, sports
I don't think they're
illegal.
Close to it.
No, but. They're not. No.
So
I don't see it for the foreseeable future, if not maybe a year or two out, maybe from this. But good for them. They got something good for their fans. VSIN made another TV deal. Their show Point Spread Weekly, hosted by Brent Musburger, is going to be aired on broadcast television, not just the Sirius channel that they have and some of their and I think through
I think their radio they have the Sirius channel and I think they I you can see their shows through their
website.
No, I don't think you can see it through the website. You can see it through the app.
Oh, okay.
Because I think the website, you have to be a subscriber, but I watch them through the app, and you don't have to be a subscriber.
Well, maybe, yeah, just one of those things. This is the first one. My LVTV is going to be carrying them starting February 15th. Actually, it was this past week. And it's the first time they're going to have a show in the Las Vegas market. I think what they're planning on doing is probably slowly wheeling this out across the country because of Sinclair Broadcasting. They've got over a couple hundred stations that could actually carry this stuff.
Are they basically Sinclair I'm talking about? Are they basically in the West?
No, they're all over
the place. Being in New Jersey,
they're
New York,
the South too.
And Pennsylvania markets, I mean, we don't have Sinclair.
No, but Sinclair is the biggie in Midwest, like Chicago, all that stuff. They're also in the South too.
Okay. So
they're all over the place. And two other things. D.C. finally did something really stupid with sports betting. They actually passed that bill where they got rid of that bidding process for sports betting operators and just gave it to their lottery, that intralot. So
the big sports operators like William Hill,
they really can't operate in there. They can in the see that's the thing. This is the weird thing about the DC. Outside of the stadiums that they're going to have the sports betting in, it's all run by Intralot. In the stadiums, it can be Intralot, it can be William Hill, it could be all these other ones.
Really?
Because the teams can make their own deals. Inside the stadium.
But don't they have to get the okay from Washington, D.C. to have these other operators outside?
They're not outside the stadiums.
Okay. All right.
As long as it's inside the stadium, you can actually use one of the other operators.
Okay.
So, and the other thing people should watch out with is West Virginia just passed a bill for online gaming and also to create four satellite locations for the racetrack casinos. And some of them have sports betting, so there may be some new sports books coming down the road if this thing moves ahead.
Interesting.
So,
good for West Virginia.
West Virginia is doing everything possible to keep up with everybody else. I don't know if they're going to be able to do it, but we'll see.
Exit 2.
China is set to overtake the United States as the highest earning esports country in 2019.
Well, don't they have the biggest stadium? Or I remember you telling me about a news story where they have a big stadium or a big training facility or something.
They have the biggest,
something weird.
The biggest dedicated stadium for esports. 13,000 people. Just for esports.
Just for esports. Wow.
You know, Luxor has their esports arena and everything else, but they use it for other things.
So. Oh, okay. So if you're going to...
Because the esports arena in the Luxor is also used for Poker Central's programming.
Okay. All right. Okay. So, but the one in China is just strictly dedicated to esports.
Yep. And this is based on the findings of several different reports. You got the prediction company BetHut and eMarketer, as well as PricewaterhouseCooper, putting together all this data from the last 20 years, and they're going to talk about the average, they're predicting the average winnings for the next 5 years. They're saying China is set up to be, to earn $45 million next year in just esports revenue alone. Now, the United States, by comparison, this past year in 2018, only earned $28 million, and they were the leader.
China was the leader, right?
No. The United States last year was the leader in $28 million.
Okay.
Next year and the year after that, they're expecting China to earn $45 million.
Oh, okay. So they think China's going to overtake U.S.
Exactly.
Well, U.S. has to do something more. I know Luxor's, you know, has the arena, but like you said, it's not a dedicated arena. Atlantic City could be doing a lot more. I know the Ocean Resort has something called the Den, which is kind of an esports section kind of thing. But, you know, it should be – I mean, I don't think there's a lot of stuff in Pennsylvania or New York. They really got to start bolstering this up because this is a moneymaker.
I just find these numbers staggering for esports. The earnings – they're anticipating the earnings of the top five players to increase by almost 40% from $2 million in 2018 that they're saying they're going to be earning over $3 million each next year.
Wow.
Or this year, 2019. So in
the U.S., some pretty important people own esport teams.
Yeah.
And this is, the sponsorships are off the charts.
They're anticipating.
Just ridiculous.
Here, they're anticipating by 2022 that esports revenues will increase annually from now to then to reach $1.58 billion.
Wow.
Worldwide. They're expecting esports viewers globally to hit the 557 million mark for people watching it. Right now, there's only 380 million. So they're anticipating another $200 million growth.
You're saying spectators. I don't know where to watch esports. I mean, do I go to, I guess, Twitch?
Twitch is the big one.
Is a big one. Twitch is big for poker players, too. I don't know why. But I don't know where else. I mean, I saw on Roku that they have an esports channel, or they're trying to get an esports channel, or I guess they're making inroads with regard to esports.
Well,
but
listen,
I haven't seen too much
esports.
Listen
to these numbers. Media rights sold globally, $181 million.
Wow.
That's how much somebody made selling the rights to their esports contest, whatever you want to call it. And sponsorships were $277 million, and also streaming advertisements made $163 million just by having streaming advertisements in these broadcasts.
Wow.
So the money there is staggering, and it's just going to get more and more, according to these reports, over the next couple of years.
Exit 3.
Now, I know we're not a NASCAR show, but we have to talk about it.
I got to tell you, I'm not a NASCAR bettor after that Daytona 500. Boy, that was awful. I don't know if I'm betting on motor racing again, ever.
I have never seen such a chaotic last couple laps.
Oh, my God. I think it started with the – what was that big wreck? The
21-car wreck.
Yeah, it was a 21-car wreck. And with it, lap, was it 10th?
As a matter of fact, they have a name for it. And
what?
I found this out in doing research for this. A couple places refer to it as, quote-unquote, the big one. and it's referring to a crash common because of restrictor plates used at the Daytona that cut down the car's horsepower.
Well, I got to tell you, it was the guy I put money on was in that one. I mean, luckily no one was hurt. I can say this and bitch and moan because no one was hurt. I just lost some cash on it. But no, that's I was looking at it in slow motion. I was like, oh, there's my guy right in the middle of it.
Well, that the big one, quote unquote, the big one knocked out 21 cars, 25 minute delay. Then they had another one that knocked out another 10 cars.
Yep.
Then the last two crashes, the 10 car and the next one, involved a total of 16 cars. And that it was the first time I've seen an overtime race in a while.
I wonder if that will improve ratings.
Ratings were up 8%.
Well, they were up 8%, I would guess, before the crash. I wonder if, number one, if sports betting helped create a more, more interest in it, because they're up 8%. And I wonder, going forward, people are going to be watching NASCAR because they might see a pileup like we saw in Daytona 500.
Well, the race was the top-rated event of the weekend, and it even beat the All-Star game. Both of these were being held in Charlotte.
I got to tell you, that's impressive, because beating the NBA All-Star game is – do they normally beat the NBA All-Star game? No.
And this is the first time they've had them in the same location at the same time.
Interesting.
11.2 rating for the 500, and then a 10.4 for the NBA All-Star game. And I noticed one other thing, that Vegas is very happy that – two of the racers did not win this race, of the remaining cars anyway.
Okay.
It's one of the few times there's been 14 drivers to finish the race that have started the race.
All right.
Let's see. Here you go. Fifth place winner was Michael McDowell. Fifth place finisher, I should say. He's not a winner if he's in fifth place. And sixth place finisher, Ty Dillon. Superbook USA had Dillon at 100-1.
Wow.
And McDowell at 80-1.
Oh, they would have been destroyed.
If Dillon had won and somebody put down...
The sports books would have been destroyed.
Here you go. A $100 bet on Dillon would have given you a $10,000 win.
Wow.
So imagine if you had about maybe a couple thousand, maybe 50, 10,000 people out there who put $100 on Dillon. That would have just destroyed the bookmakers. And I think for the first time, nationwide sports betting is very happy that Hamlin won.
I got to tell you, you're talking about the ratings. I mean, I watched more NASCAR than I did the NBA All-Star game.
He was, by the way, Hamlin was a 10-1.
Wow.
To win the Daytona 500. This is his second time in 4 years in winning it, too. And he was still only a 10-1 odds on finishing it.
Exit four
is a combination of two things, because we got high tech, and I guess we can call this low tech here in this exit. Adam Silver in the NBA unveiled the future of NBA jerseys. And it was basically a jersey that could be altered just by the push of a button to change the name and the number on the back of the jersey.
See, I misunderstood when I heard this story. I didn't think it was going to be the name and the number. I assumed that it was going to be the advertisement on their shirts. Now, they have one advertiser for the first quarter, another advertiser for the second quarter. That's what I thought they were changing on the shirts. I didn't think it would be the name and the number of the player.
Well, you got to think about this. This is the NBA Tech Summit. They have every year with the All-Star game, they have this thing where they show these different technologies. Mm-hmm. First of all, this isn't going to be available, if ever, until 2030.
I'm assuming they could use it the way I'm talking about.
They could, but they designed it in the presentation to only change the name and number. Now, I don't see the purpose of this.
That's stupid.
Because stupid. I can't see the NBA selling just one jersey. The fact that you have all these different jerseys to sell is what makes the NBA some money on the side with this revenue with the uniform stuff.
They don't want it to be the names and numbers of the players. They want it for the advertising on the jerseys.
Well, think about it.
That's the first thing I thought of, and that's the first thing they thought of.
The NBA is the most savvy of the leagues in terms of revenue making, in terms of sports betting, in terms of anything.
Adam Silver, I think, was the first commissioner to come out, and he said, sports betting's a reality. You have to deal with it.
And so I just think this is their way of introducing it. They're going to flip it around. They're going to put it on the front. They're going to get the advertising on.
Sure.
You might even see revolving advertising throughout the game.
That's what I was thinking. First quarter is brought to you by this advertiser. The second quarter is brought to you by this other advertiser. You know, you can change the advertisers. You can change the advertisers on the shirt, the court, the basketball. Who knows?
Well, if you think about it, they can still do that now. They just have to change shirts in between periods.
Sure.
Yeah, this will save some time. And on the low-tech spectrum of this.
I can't believe this is low-tech. This is high-tech about like
when we were
40
young.
Years ago.
Yes. A first-run copy of the Nintendo game Super Mario Brothers sold for $100,000. $100,000 and $100,150 for a completely sealed-up Nintendo game of Super Mario Brothers. The first one that was on the market because it was in a box. And not a packaging. It was in a plastic box for the game. It was unopened, unsealed.
This must have been in like someone's storage or some store's storage, because who gets a Mario Brothers and keeps it closed and not plays it? I couldn't wait to get with these games and open them up and play them.
I wouldn't be surprised if this was in some guy's, you know, somebody was running one of those stores like Blockbuster or something that had the games to rent.
Yeah, they found a whole bunch of them.
Right, and the store's closed, so they found them in the back room or something. But this broke the record of the other copy of Super Mario Brothers that sold in 2017 for over $30,000. So quite a leap.
Wow, boy.
Well, see, this one was in a special container, this $100,000 version.
Oh, this must have been like a collector's edition kind of thing.
Well, this was actually sold for a brief period of time. The boxes contained the very first Super Mario Brothers sold in America.
Okay.
So they did some improvements on the game after it came into America. Mm-hmm. It was sealed on the top flap, and there was a black foil circular sticker with the Nintendo logo on it. So this was immaculate. Whoever had this, it's the only known sealed copy of the first U.S. print run of a Super Mario Brothers game.
I gotta tell you, Super Mario Brothers was even after our time, because
Donkey Kong led to Mario Brothers.
Right, Donkey Kong. I love Donkey Kong.
What was it? Mario was the one who was trying.
Mario
to
get, was the one. You, you
I don't know to, the name of the girl anymore.
I forgot her name. I absolutely forgot her name. No, I don't know, but I can picture Donkey Kong. I loved it on the Atari 2600, it was great.
Yeah, and then you had the Adam Sandler movie just a little while ago, Pixels.
Okay.
Where they were doing all the 80s video games coming to life, and it ended with Donkey Kong. Mm-hmm. You know, he had to take the role of Mario. But Super Mario Brothers was the offshoot, sequel
or
spin-off.
Yeah, I guess spin-off is a good word.
And they're still making Super Mario Brothers games now, but nothing like this one. I mean, I saw some pictures of this, and it was the old pixelated Mario from Donkey Kong.
It probably still looked better than Donkey Kong, though.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I'm going to remind everyone that today's trip down to Turnpike is brought to you by Drizly, your online liquor store, available in over 95 cities across North America. Drizly offers a huge selection and competitive pricing with a side of personalized content. Now there's no need to leave the house. Get alcohol delivered in less than an hour by Drizly. Head on over to drizly.com and order today. And now get $5 off your first order of $20 or more when using promo code DRINK19 at checkout. Shop beer, wine, and liquor with drizly.com.
And as always, to get in touch with us over here at Turnpike Sports, you can call or text us at 609-512-5910. 609-512-5910. If you're watching us on TV, we have a screen with all the contact information at Turnpike Sports on Facebook or Twitter. Our email address is info@turnpikesportsradio.com. Don't forget to order your International Bikini Team calendar. info@internationalbikiniteam.org is the email address for ordering information. And don't forget to catch the show on your smart TVs, Roku, Amazon Fire, Apple TV, through our distributors, Binge Networks, iTunes. You can subscribe to the show. We're also distributed by iHeartMedia, Stitcher Radio, YouTube, and also go head on over to TurnpikeSportsRadio.com and click on the podcast button to listen to this show and every other show we've done preceding it.
And stick around, because after this, I talk to Matthew Cullen, who's the Senior Vice President of Interactive Gaming and Sports at Parx Casino. We're going to talk about sports betting, Parx Casino, and what's coming up online for Parx Casino. So stick around. We'll be right back with more Turnpike Sports.
Hey, this is Dave Weishuttle from Turnpike Sports with this week's Bet Flash. The Pennsylvania Gaming Control Board released its numbers for the Keystone State Sportsbooks for January. The handle from the State 6 Sportsbooks was $32 million, which generated $2.6 million in revenue. The big winner was Philadelphia's Sugar House Casino, which had a handle of $10.7 million at their book. New Jersey has a new online sportsbook. Golden Nugget in Atlantic City went live with their online book earlier this week and is offering new players a $50 refund on its first qualifying bet. The new online book is available on desktop, Android, and Apple devices. Former New Jersey Governor Chris Christie is being inducted into the Sports Betting Hall of Fame. Governor Christie had been instrumental in New Jersey's case to prove that the Professional and Amateur Sports Protection Act, or PASPA, was unconstitutional. The induction ceremony is being held on April 25th in New York City. Congratulations, Governor Christie. From the seaside to the desert, from the betting lines to the sites online, Turnpike Sports has got you covered. And be sure to follow us on Twitter at Turnpike Sports. Bright Tech offers unique no-dust lighting products that fit right into your home, no construction required. Elevated designs should be available to everyone, not just the folks with the big bank accounts. Trick out your living room, create your perfect reading nook. Whatever the situation, Bright Tech has a lighting solution for you. And now get 5% off of your entire order when using our promo code RADIO5OFF at checkout. Head on over to brighttechshop.com and start designing the life you want. Bright Tech, your bright life realized.
You've been hearing me talk about MyPillow and the benefits of using it to get a good night's sleep, alleviate your sore neck and back, and the special deal you can get for MyPillow through the show. Well, not only can you pick up the special deal for four MyPillows when you use promo code CARDS, but now you can get $100 off your purchase of the MyPillow mattress. Yeah, that's right, the MyPillow mattress. The MyPillow mattress comes with a 10-year warranty and a 120-day money-back guarantee. The MyPillow mattress is made up of three unique layers, providing you the comfort and support to fall asleep and stay asleep all night. It even has the luxurious Dream Soft cover, which is stain-resistant and stays cool all night. Just head on over to MyPillow.com, click on the MyPillow mattress link, and enter promo code CARDS at checkout to get $100 off your order. Or call 1-800-319-7913 to order by phone. That's MyPillow.com or call 1-800-319-7913 and use promo code CARDS. Better sleep starts with MyPillow.
Free stuff is awesome, but free stuff that will spice up your bedroom is even better. Just go to adamandeve.com and select almost any one item for 50% off, and then we'll load on the free stuff. Just enter this very exclusive code, BABE16, at checkout, and you'll get 10 tantalizing free gifts, including a sexy item for him, a special toy for her,
ooh,
and a third item you'll both enjoy.
Ooh.
And for your viewing pleasure, 6 free spicy movies on DVD, plus
free shipping.
Always sent in discreet packaging. So go to adamandeve.com now. Get 50% off plus 10 free gifts when you enter the exclusive offer code BABE16. Again, that's BABE16. Because without it,
no free stuff.
That's BABE16 at adamandeve.com.
We'll get right back to the show, but I want to take a minute to talk to you about Bean Genius. How would you like your coffee delivered right to your door every month, maybe two times a month? Well, now that can happen with Bean Genius. Bean Genius sells freshly roasted coffee from some of the best independent coffee roasters in the country at beangenius.com. And Bean Genius actually learns their customers' individual taste preferences, then suggests future coffee blends for them. Well, how do they do that? Well, this is the cool thing about Bean Genius. Over at beangenius.com, they use an algorithm which learns the coffee flavors you like and then pairs up what you like with the coffee that they have in stock. And it's all based upon you. Every time you order, the system learns. The system learns your preferences as you go along and order more and more coffee. And now, all our listeners at Turnpike Sports can get a special offer. You head on over to beangenius.com/subscription, and you'll be able to get 10% off your purchase when you use our promo code PIKE, P-I-K-E, at checkout. That's 10% off at beangenius.com/subscription with promo code PIKE, P-I-K-E. Beangenius.com, the smart specialty coffee subscription service.
I bet you $20 I can get you gambling before the end of the day.
No way.
I'll give you 3-1 odds.
Nope.
5-1.
Nope.
10-1.
You're on.
When Welcome back to Turnpike Sports. You know, for those who listen to the show know that Parx Casino is one of my favorite casinos in the world. Every time I go there, I think this place can't get any better. And guess what? It just got better because now it has sports betting. And to talk all about it, we have Matthew Cullen, who is Senior Vice President of Interactive Gaming and Sports at Parx Casino. Matthew, thanks for joining us.
Happy to be here. Thanks for having me.
Matthew, as I said, I think Parx is one of the premier casinos in the country, but for people who aren't familiar with the casino, can you tell us a little bit about the property?
Yeah, I mean, we started off actually as a racetrack, like most other casinos here in Pennsylvania and other parts of the country. And then I guess it was technically about 12 years ago when legislation was enacted in Harrisburg, the state capital. We built a facility adjacent to the track, that has slot machines and table games, a beautiful poker room, and now we have a sports book here. We also have a number of amenities. We're located in Bensalem, Pennsylvania, about 30 minutes north of Philadelphia, up 95, and we draw from really a tri-state area, obviously southeastern Pennsylvania and the Philly market, southeastern or southwestern and eastern parts of New Jersey and northern New Jersey, and then upwards to the New York City area. So a really nice facility, Las Vegas style casino. First time I walked in here, probably 7 or 8 years ago, I didn't even know, couldn't even tell that I was in Philadelphia,
yeah,
Pennsylvania,
yeah,
when I walked through the front doors.
You know, I got to tell you, I'm a big Philly sports fan, and I always say there's nothing better than watching a game at Parx, but now you've taken the experience to a whole new level because, as you said, you now have a sports book. Tell us something about the sports book.
Well, we launched it almost 5 weeks ago. We have two locations currently, one here at Parx at the casino, which is a temporary sports book. In our 360 lounge, if folks remember that situation there where we used to have some bands and DJs. Mm-hmm. But we took all the tables out of that area. We put up a multitude of high-def TV screens, 55 and 70-inch TV screens. We've got two 16x9 television high-def TVs as well up on the stage area. We've got a full bar. We've got seven over-the-counter locations where our Parx tellers can take bets from patrons. And then we also have 14 self-service kiosks in the facility to take bets. And then we've got an additional, 16 or so kiosks located around the casino floor itself. So we can virtually take sports bets virtually anywhere on property.
So these kiosks are located across the gaming floor and throughout the property?
That's right. We've got them in some of our restaurants. We've
Wow.
got some in our poker room. We've got some around some of our bar areas throughout the casino. We wanted to put them in spots where people tend to congregate and spend time here when they come on property. And then obviously we've got the lion's share of those SSTVs, as we call them, inside the sports book itself.
Now, the sports book at the Parx property in Bensalem, you said that's a temporary place. Where do
Yes.
you plan on moving the permanent one? I know you have a second building where the race book is on the property.
Yep.
Are you going to move the sports book to that building?
We're still trying to figure out those plans, but it's more than likely going to go in the northern corner of the casino,
okay,
next to the Liberty Bell Gastro Pub and in front of our new beer garden, which we opened about a month ago as well. We've got a shell space right now that we have some plans to build out, and we're just trying to figure out if we want to move in that direction. One of the tougher things to try and figure out in front of online gaming launching and sports betting launching in Pennsylvania is, how much of a retail presence do you need?
Yeah.
Once everybody has the ability to bet on their phone and on a computer when that launches. So we're trying to forecast some of that right now, and it's really a bit of a challenge.
Mm-hmm.
But we would build that permanent sports book, if you will, if we move forward with those plans in the northern corner of the facility.
You know, the one thing that I think it's great and that really sets Parx apart from every other sports book is you have something called the Bet Slip Builder. Can you explain to everyone what your Bet Slip Builder is and how it works?
Yeah, we definitely, from a product perspective, our team has a mobile-first mentality. You know, everybody's walking around with a smartphone, either or not, typically an iPhone or an Android phone in their pocket. When they come on property, and then obviously when they're home. It's become such an everyday part of everyone's lives. And it's no different with sports and sports betting. We look at New Jersey, and from an online perspective, a majority of the wagering that occurs from folks that open online accounts is done through a mobile device. So ahead of launching online gaming in PA, we wanted to get a jump start on that. And so what we did was we created an app that sits in, at least with Apple, in the iTunes store that patrons can download. They can look at all of our lines and all of our markets that we offer across all the different sports and betting categories. Mm-hmm. And they can build, effectively, while they're outside the casino, they can build the various bets that they want to place when they come on property. And then when they come on property, they can go up to one of our counter positions and scan a QR code through that application and place their bets on property. So it just gives people an opportunity to plan what they want to bet before they get here. And it gives us a touch point with our customers when they're away from us through their mobile devices. And then obviously when online gaming does start, the intention would be to try and flip all those folks that do have those apps on their phone over to open account-based wagering accounts with us and start wagering on their phones live when we're able to offer that activity.
Well, let me ask you something about the bet slip creator, the bet mm-hmm. slip builder, I guess it's called. Mm-hmm. Now, I live in South Jersey. Will I be able to prepare my bet slip in New Jersey, and when I come to Parx, will I be able to just scan it in, or do I have to prepare the bet slip in Pennsylvania? Is it geolocation sensitive? Or
no, there right now there isn't any geolocation technology in it because there's no account, there's no wallet. We're not taking any credit card information. There's no depositing of funds or anything like that. So all it is informational. So you could access it from anywhere inside the U.S. or overseas. And be able to look at, you know, the lines in real time and be able to build your bets. And then, like I said earlier, when you come on property, you can go up to the counter and scan those bets, get in and out of the property quickly if you're in a hurry and want to get that done.
That's a great feature. That's excellent. Now, you alluded to this before, the physical sports book at Parx in Bensalem, but that's not the only thing that Parx runs. Tell us something about the South Philly Turf Club, and you're going to have a new one, the Valley Forge Turf Club.
Yeah, we're going through the process right now with the Valley Forge. With South Philly, we opened up a week after the facility here in Bensalem, the sports book here. And we opened a sports book down there, right in the middle of all the stadiums here in South Philadelphia.
I got to tell you, that's a great location.
Great location.
Oh, it's absolutely great.
And we have a very large turf club where folks come in on a daily basis and bet on horse racing throughout the U.S. and frankly throughout the world through simulcast means. And we opened a sports book there. We put in dozens of new high def TVs down there. Total investment on that property was a little over $1 million.
Wow.
To upgrade that facility, along with food and beverage. And we take the bet slip builder. That functionality works down there as well. We have over the counter tellers down there, as well as the self-service betting terminals, those kiosks that I mentioned. We've got those throughout that facility. And you're right, we're going to open a third facility, provided everything goes well. We have to get, we need to get the blessing of Pennsylvania Horse Racing Commission. And then we have to go before the Pennsylvania Gaming Control Board. But we'll be doing that in the next couple weeks. And then the plan is to go through a couple test days for the Pennsylvania Gaming Control Board, making sure that we're operating under their guidelines. And then we would hopefully go live a week or so, maybe a little more than a week before March Madness starts at Valley Forge.
Wow, that's pretty quick.
Yeah.
Now I got to ask you, and you talked a little bit about it. What's been very successful for the sports books in New Jersey, where I live, is the online sports book platforms. But Pennsylvania has yet to approve that aspect of sports betting. However, Parx does have an online presence with regard to sports betting right now. What is Parx Casino doing right now with regard to online sports betting or sports? I guess they're calling it predictions in some circles.
Yeah, we did offer a prediction game ahead of, much like we did with the Bet Slip Builder, trying to get out in front of things that we can do to drive fan and customer engagement, either through mobile devices or computers on the desktop while our players are away from us. So we were offering, and we stopped offering those games about a month ago. When sports betting launched, retail sports betting launched, we were offering some sports prediction games to win prizes. It's just one more way to engage customers ahead of regulated gaming, regulated casino gaming, and regulated sports betting being offered across interactive devices. It's just something that we thought of to engage those customers and get the Parx brand front and center and try and continue to keep our leadership position in the marketplace.
How close do you think Pennsylvania is allowing online real money sports betting or, you know, online casinos as well? I mean, how close are they to launching this?
Well, the honest answer is we don't know. Mm-hmm. We hope it's within months. We'd hope it's within a few months or a couple months. But we would hope to have some answers here in the next month or so, I would say, and to be able to get a firm date. But at the moment, we don't have that. So my team are still continuing to prepare for when we launch. And, you know, we just continue to hope that it's not too far in the distant future.
You know, I know this last month in Jersey that close to 80% of the revenue from sports betting came from the online sports books. Do you think that's going to influence Pennsylvania lawmakers to help put online sports betting and online casinos on a fast track to becoming legal, or are they just going to move at their own pace?
Well, they've already passed laws. Some of the heavy lifting has already been done. The legislature's already passed the laws to legalize sports betting and online casino and mobile sports betting and mobile casino in the state. The regulations are more or less drawn up as well. Now it's just a question of the regulator feeling comfortable with the various licensees like Parx and their technology platforms to allow them to go live. I think it's just a matter of time. Mm-hmm. And hopefully, like I said before, we're just a couple months away, but yeah, I think they're just trying to make sure that all their ducks are in a row before they shoot off the starting gun, if you will, and then the various brands go online, much like you saw, like you alluded to in New Jersey, when they all went live in July and August timeframe.
Now, you come from a background of online gaming and corporate development. What do you see as the major challenges for companies who want to do online sports betting or online casinos in Pennsylvania? Have they learned the lessons from New Jersey and Delaware, or are there specific challenges for Pennsylvania?
I think there's a couple big challenges that we have in front of us that some of the other states don't necessarily have, and one big one is the tax burden.
Yeah.
We've got some rather large tax rates for both online casino gaming as well as sports betting. So I think, you know, you've probably seen a lot of the advertising in New Jersey, particularly
sure.
around sports betting and probably online casino as well. When you have a lower tax threshold, it allows you to be a bit more aggressive with your marketing dollars and go out and try and acquire customers through various means a little more aggressively. I think what we'll see in PA, because of that tax rate and the margin on our business is going to be that much less because of that, I think people are going to be try and be a lot more judicious and smarter about where they spend their marketing dollars, probably a lot more creative as well to try and acquire customers. But you know, for us, not being a digital brand in the sense that we've got this wonderful facility and You know, we've got tens of thousands of people coming through the facility every week. As a result of that, we've got strong brand affinity across the state. We've got a fantastic database of players, people that like the Parx brand, that come to us and play with us on a weekly basis. I just think we're set up to do really well because we've already got a lot of engaged players. Mm-hmm. But I think, you know, going back to your original question, the tax rate's probably the biggest challenge that I see in PA as we get ready for launch.
You know, you hit on something that I was going to ask you. When Pennsylvania does go online with sports betting, how do you think it'll fit into the market with regard to the competing states like New Jersey and West Virginia? I'm asking this because I know that some poker sites have an interstate compact with each other. Mm-hmm. I know Nevada and New Jersey share their player pools for online poker. Do you see that mm-hmm. something like that coming relatively soon with regard to sports betting, or do you think it'll be state by state right now?
It's probably going to be state by state, particularly around sports. Mm-hmm. And I think the jury's still out with regards to poker and any other state-to-state compacts. You follow the industry. You're probably very familiar with the Department of Justice and
sure, sure.
a letter that they issued last month in mid-January with regards to the federal law, the Wire Act. And there's a new interpretation of that law, which has a lot of us in the online gaming industry trying to figure out exactly how this is going to play out ultimately. And I think it's probably safe to say that the days of state compacts probably are in the rearview mirror.
Okay.
Maybe that's not the case. We'll have to wait and see. But certainly with regards to sports, I don't think we'll see any compacts. I think what we're going to see is very much an intrastate model that will go state by state. So New Jersey, PA, Delaware, West Virginia, each one of those individual states will have their own player liquidity pool, and there won't be sharing of customers over state lines. I hope that's not the case,
mm-hmm.
but I think based on what happened with the Department of Justice last month, it's probably likely.
Did that really affect your marketing plans for Parx, or were you going on a tracked regardless of the new opinion from the DOJ?
It didn't affect our marketing plans. It affected some of our technical plans.
Okay.
In terms of where we were going to host and serve things from. You know, we actually have aspirations, which I didn't mention at the beginning of the discussion, to be in New Jersey and PA, because we, you know, obviously online sports betting and online casino gaming is legal in both jurisdictions.
Sure.
We definitely have aspirations to do it in both states because of our player. So many of our players and existing patrons come from Pennsylvania and New Jersey. And it just makes, from a technical standpoint, our plans play out a little bit differently. So rather than just host and serve all of our applications and our websites from New Jersey and or PA for the other state, we've got to set up technology in both states. Makes it a little bit more expensive. I wouldn't necessarily say that it's affected our marketing plans much.
Mm-hmm.
Our marketing plans are somewhat different because of the tax burden in PA compared to the lesser tax rate in New Jersey. But it's really just the technical stuff that so far that it's affected. Hopefully it's not further reaching from there.
Sure. Right now, Parx has had sports betting for only a few weeks, but in your opinion, how is it going and is it growing right now?
It is growing. It depends on the day, obviously, because sports betting can be a rather volatile business,
mm-hmm.
depending on your lines and depending on obviously what happens in the contests that people are wagering on. And do the favorites win or do we see a lot of underdogs win? It has grown week to week. I think we're in week six right now. We've been very pleased with the rollout thus far. It's been rather smooth. Not to say that we haven't had some hiccups. I think in any business, any new business, you're going to have those things come up. But all in all, we've done very well, and we're quite pleased.
Yeah, I know you guys had a great event for the Super Bowl. I think you had former Eagle Brian Westbrook there, and I know some big betting events are coming up in the weeks in March. I know March Madness is coming pretty soon. Where can people go to check out what's going on at the Parx Sportsbook and at the Parx Casino? Is there a website that people can go to?
Yeah, if you go to parxcasino.com, you can see everything, all of our scheduled events, including any acts that we have downstairs, or any certainly sports betting events. March Madness, you mentioned, is a big one that's coming up.
Sure.
We're going to be doing a lot around that. But you can find all of that information on parxcasino.com.
Matthew, we're running out of time, but I want to tell everyone, if they have not done so yet, get to Parx Casino. It has some of the best games, best service, best restaurants, and now one of the best sports books in the country. Matthew Cullen, Senior Vice President of Interactive Gaming and Sports at Parx Casino, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate the time.
All right. Hey, have a great sports weekend, and we'll see you next time on the Turnpike.